الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ بدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وشفي ذنوبنا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين واللعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من يومنا هذا إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وجاهدوا في الله حق جهاده هو اجتباكم وما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات السلام عليكم ورحمة الله We have been requested by the family of Marhoom Muhammad Taqi Muhammad Hussain Rai Devji to recite a majlis on a special topic because today is his 40th anniversary since he passed away, and also all the marhumin whose names were mentioned and displayed on the screen. May I request you once more to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. Maliki Yawmiddin Iyyaka Na'budu Wa Iyyaka Nasta'in Ihdina Siratal Mustaqim Siratal Ladzina An'amta Alayhim Ghayril Maghdubi Alayhim Waladdallin. The ayat of Quran which I recited at the beginning of Majlis is the last verse from Surah Al-Hajj. Surah Al-Hajj is Surah number 22 of the Quran, and this is the only Surah which contains two sajdas. In the Quran, there are four wajib sajdas and there are 11 mustahab sajdas. This is the only Surah which contains two mustahab sajdas. The last verse of this Surah, Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَجَاهِدُوا فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِ وَاجْتَبَاكُمْ وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجِ Allah says that just strive hard in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way it is supposed to be done. Haqqa jihad, right? Then says, وَاجْتَبَاكُمْ Allah is the one who has chosen you. That means Muslims have been chosen for a special mission. Allah is the one who has chosen you, right? وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجِ This sentence, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجِ is quite interesting. Allah says, He has not imposed in you in religion any kind of hardship. Subhanallah, وَمَا جَعَلَ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجِ Allah has not imposed in religion any kind of hardships. And we know this thing, right? As far as Haqqa Jihad is concerned, no, in Majmul Bayan, Sheikh Tabrizi says that it means when you struggle in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should have a sincere niyat. All of us took a trouble to leave our home, come to the Husainiyah to participate in the program this evening, including Salat al-Jama'ah, right? So we do that sincerely. So when we struggle sincerely, that is haqqa juhadi. No, that's why it says, وَجَاهِدُ فِي اللَّهِ حَقَّ جِهَادِ The way it is supposed to be done. Most important, whatever we do, it should be done sincerely. Allah is the one who has chosen us for a special mission. That this is the final message, which we are the one who would read it, try to understand it, and try to follow it. So Allah has chosen us. Then it says, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجِ In the religion, Allah has not imposed any kind of hardships on you. Why have we discussed this thing? Because today we are gathered here to remember one marhum, Marhum Muhammad Taqi Bhai Devji, those of us who used to visit him, he could not even talk, could not articulate, could not express himself since 2005 when he had a second minor operation. His major surgery took 2005, but in 2010, when he had a minor surgery, after that there was a turnaround in his life that he could not even talk easily. He could not express himself. And as we used to visit him all the time, I realized one thing, that the community needs to be reminded, especially myself and others who don't do this thing often, that what are the rights of the disabled and how do we support them. So on account of the request from the family, inshallah, in the remaining time we have, we will discuss few rights of the disabled and how do we support them. But this ayat is quite interesting. Remember, Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ, that Allah has not imposed hardships on you in the religion. When a person is sick, there are special exemptions on that person. In fact, Mawlana Sahib, our resident alim, has a book titled, The Salat for the Disabled, a small booklet, whereby he's discussing about different masails, right? And you'll find that if a person cannot stand while saying prayers, he would do what? The first thing is, would lean against a wall. Or for example, take a staff. If he cannot still do that, then he would sit. If he cannot still sit, then of course he would just lie down. So there are the kind of exemptions. When a person is traveling, 4 rakat becomes 2 rakat. You know, sometimes people come to us and say this question, when I'm traveling, I've got more time than I'm back home. Why should I not recite 4 rakat? Why 2 rakat? Can I say 4 rakat? He said, you are forgetting the principle. The principle here is, maybe you have got a lot of time, but the fact that you are traveling, you may be discomforted, maybe you do not have all the facilities. Allah has given you a special exemption that for every 4 rakat, you must say 2 rakat. There is no choice. Only other exemption is, for example, if you are in Makkah or Medina, or if you are in Masjid al-Kufa, or in the Haram of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it's a different thing, right? Otherwise, if you stay in a place less than 10 days, you are traveling, you must say 2 rakat for every 4 rakat, Zuhr, Asr, and Isha. But the principle, underlying principle is that kind of exemption given to us on account of discomfort. So in the same way, these people who are in fact sick, who are disabled, or sometimes we say they are handicapped, right? The right word is disabled, which we use, that there is a special exemption. And especially as far as the religion is concerned, the Prophet says, وَإِسْتُ بِالْحَنِيفَةِ سَمْحَةِ, right? He in fact told to Abu Zar, Abu Zar, I have been raised with Shariat, with an easy Hanafi way, an upright way which is easy. That means he himself says that my Sharia is that which is easy. On account of circumstances, it's easy. In fact, when Prophet sent 2 of his people to Yemen to go and do tabligh, Prophet advised them, Bashira wala tunaffira, wa yassira wala tu'assira, right? He said, give good news and do not repel them. Make things easy for people and do not make things difficult for them. Do you see, this is what religion is. Prophet is sending 2 of his people, you know, the names were Ma'ad ibn Jabal and Abu Musa, and says, make sure that you give them good news. Do not repel them. Make things easy for them. Not make difficulty. It is we who make things difficult. I was in India in 1989, also went recently, but in 89, first time I went there, somebody said, interesting, in Gujarati, and many of us understood, I said, dharma mar sido che, par pandit ada aave che. We are the one who make things difficult, right? Religion is simple and easy. So you can see, Prophet sends people to Yemen and says, make sure that you give good news and do not repel them. Right? Make things easier. So especially those who are sick, those who are disabled, those who need help, there should be special exemption for them. So what are their rights? Let's look at it. The first right, brothers and sisters, for those who are disabled, right, is that we treat them as normal human beings. Let's make sure that we don't consider them as abnormal. Like Dakibi Amarhum, right? He was an active person, used to serve the community. He was able to translate in 7 languages, right? And always would try to talk to people about religion, and even to non-Muslims, talk to them about the good things about Islam, right? Suddenly a time comes in 2010, after a minor surgery he had, you know, he was suffering from Parkinson's, he could no longer talk. So people sometimes have that disability, it's not that they're born with. Even if they were born with, it doesn't mean that we should treat them abnormally. We should treat them normally. When you find them coming into the masajid, greet them, show them a face of, you know, welcoming, smile with them. It's very important. Sometimes people treat them as if these are outsiders, these are strangers. No, these are fellow believers, mu'mineen, who on account of certain things in their life have now become sick and become disabled. So it is very important that we treat them normally. There is a hadith from the Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whereby Prophet says, لا تديم النظر إلى أهل البلاء والمجذومين فإن ذلك يحزنهم. سبحان الله. Prophet says that do not stare at people who are in difficulty or who are disabled, because your staring at them would do what? Would hurt their feelings, would grieve them. Do you see this thing? Just staring is not allowed. Leave alone passing the comment. Leave alone, for example, telling somebody to sukarwanyaywach. This is not a place for you. You cannot walk, you cannot talk, you cannot, for example, help yourself. What are you doing here? We can't do that. You know, Prophet says you cannot even stare at them. Just staring at them would hurt their feelings. You can see they're already physically, for example, disabled. Now when we hurt their feelings, we are hurting them even mentally, right? Their esteem is being robbed on account of our comments. So Prophet says, do not even stare at them, those who are in difficulty or those who are disabled, right? The second right of theirs is, let us accord them due respect. When people come into the Imam Barga, in Masajid, in our centers, depending who you are, you find your friends will come, talk to you, right? And welcome you, ask you, where have you been if you're not here? All those kind of, you know, we have that special exchange of greetings and we socialize at the time of taking tea. But you find people who are disabled, people, for example, who need help. Sometimes we find them that they are all alone, right? No one is there to ask about them other than own family members. For example, if the person has come with his son or she has come with her daughter, right? Only they would be there. Let us, you know, give them due respect. It is important that if we don't respect them, what would happen is that they would hesitate to come to the center, right? In fact, we go out of them. When I say respect, that means usually we don't respect everybody. You respect what Maulana is there, respect the leaders, respect your friend, your uncle, right? But here is a mu'min, a mu'mina, who is disabled, right? Has one day found the time to come to the masjid. Has one day decided to participate in the program. Let us accord them due respect. We go out of our way and talk to them. Ask them, how are you feeling? What can we do to help you, right? We are so pleased to see you. You should come again and again. Let us accord them due respect. If we don't do that, what would happen? A time would come that they would stop coming to the programs totally. They would hesitate doing that, right? It is important. Let me share with you an incident which is found in the Quran, which is quite interesting. In Surah number 24, which is Surah An-Nur, there's an ayat. Ayat number 61 discusses, Allah is telling us that if you want to go and eat in the houses, which are those houses you can just go without taking permission? You go to the house of your father, your mother, your brother, right? All these houses Allah mentioned. But before mentioning those houses whereby we can go and eat the food, Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيدِ حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَنفُسَكُمْ أَن تَأْكُلُوا مِن بُيُوتِكُمْ. Before Allah says that where you can eat the food, He says that there is no blame on the person who is blind to eat, or the one who is lame, or the one who is sick to eat in the houses. What happened? Why does Allah begin by saying that there is no blame for somebody who is lame, somebody who is sick, somebody who is, for example, blind to eat? What was there? In Tafsir Nur al-Thaqalain, there's a hadith from the fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Whereby Imam says that, you know, before Islam, the blind, the lame, and the sick were not allowed to eat food with healthy people. This verse permitted them to eat food in a group with healthy people, or if they wanted, they can eat on their own. So you can imagine there was a custom. And why was this? In another tafsir, I was looking for this, preparing for this majlis, another tafsir says, a blind person could not know, right? As in olden days, we did not have our own plates, right? They used to take them. There was a main plate. People would just eat from the same plate. So what happens? If a person is blind, he would not know where to keep his hand. And also, for example, if he wants to take potatoes or, for example, meat, he would not be able to find because he's blind, right? So people felt that either we are depriving them because they cannot find, or they would, for example, put their hands in a wrong place and people would not comfortable with that. This was as far as the blinds were concerned. As far as the lame were concerned, they could not, there were no, the concept of tables was not there. People used to sit and eat down, right? They would sit down and eat, right? So they could not sit with comfort because of they were lame, right? And the sick, of course, what they cannot feel like eating, or they just eat and stand up. So on account of this particular thing, there was a custom, there was a culture amongst the Muslims, amongst the Arabs, before this ayat came, that they would not be feel comfortable. Rather, they were embarrassed to eat with these people because they have to help them or things they'll do. An ayat of Quran comes special, you can see. Allah says, وَلَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٌ وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيدِ حَرَجٌ. And the word haraj comes three times. That there is no blame. There is no difficulty, right? That a person who is blind, there is no blame on him. A person who is a lame, there is no blame on him. A person who is a sick, there is no blame on him. That if he eats food with others. Do you see this thing? So a special ayat is revealed just to overcome this custom. That these people who are handicapped or disabled, who are sick, who perhaps cannot interact in the society normally, should not be treated differently. Allah says especially that there is no blame for them to eat with others in the houses. Before even Allah says, where I can eat, for example, I can go to my father's house, my mother's house, my sister's house. Those are different, that come later on. But the first thing Allah does is mention these people, just on account of this custom which used to exist. So it is important that when the disabled come to the community centers, let us accord them due respect. Let's go out of our way to inquire about them. It will make a difference, right? They will feel like coming. They know that, okay, I'm welcome there. The third right of people who are disabled is, let us accommodate our programs and our spaces to facilitate them. It is important. Sometimes the programs are so long, right? Or sometimes it's so difficult for a handicapped person, for a disabled person to get into the Imam Raga and live. There is no easy access. We have built, mashallah, such a big center. Now we are about to, you know, finish our paying our debt. These are the things we need to consider. Those of us who go to Qum for Ziyarat, you must have noticed that recently, only about the last few years, they built a huge hall known as Shabistan Imam Khomeini in the Haram, near the Haram. They're huge. Before that, things were different. Now, if you go to there, there are three facilities, there are three sections there. There's a section for ladies, there's a section for gents, and there's a section which is common. Because people who are disabled, for example, there are family members who cannot, for example, send their sons away, right, or daughters away to other side. So they would like to have a place whereby they can be there together. Husband and wife has to be together because of children or somebody disabled, right? So there is a section which is common. This is in the Haram, just near the Haram. There is no extremism there. They say, no, 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 this is Haram, you cannot do this thing. Especially arrangement is made. So it is important that our spaces should be such that these people can come into the center easily and also exit easily. Because sometimes they can come, but when going out is a big deal. That should not be the case, right? So it is important that also the programs, it is very important that the program should not be very long. You realize that in the last, you know, few months, maybe 2 or 3 years or so, Maulana has decided to drop Zuhr Namaz on Fridays. We have Fajr Namaz, and immediately after that, there is Asr Namaz. Why? Because according to Fatwa of Ayatollah Sistani, if Jummah is said with all the conditions, then that suffices over Dhuhr. Then you don't need to say Dhuhr. Yeah, there are other maraj who might have their own different fatwas, but since many of us do the creed of Ayatollah Sistani, that is his fatwa. that if Jummah is said with all the conditions, inshallah the conditions are there. We got the imam who is, you know, adil, we got other conditions which are there, right? That there is no namaz Jummah within a shorter distance. With all the conditions are there, then Jummah suffices over Zuhr. So how long does the Zuhr take? People, when they were saying the Zuhr time, how long did it take? 5 minutes? We were saying Zuhr individual, right? Furada after Jummah. But even that, Maulana dropped out. He said, no, just leave it so that people can come. It's important that we make programs which are not that long so people can participate, right? This is not as far as the rights are concerned. As far as the support is concerned, I don't have much time. I'll very go quickly, just give the points. One is, let us inquire about their condition, about their welfare. Brothers, if you know somebody is suffering in the community, let's inquire about them. Whether you want to visit them, whether you want to call them, whether you want to ask their children, their family members, it is important that we do this thing. Because then they feel that, no, we take a pride that our community is like extended family, right? So let us actually extend our relations to these people also. The second, of course, support is visit regularly. When you visit these people regularly, then only you come to know. Although I know Taqi Bhai Marhum for many years because he was in Vancouver when I was there. When before I came there, he was there. He lived in Vancouver for 26 years. So, of course, I knew him from there. But when I visited him again and again at his place in hospitals, I came to know him and even appreciate him even more, right? I built that respect for him, about his iman, about his faith, that how much, you know, committed that person was, even at this stage. His condition, his always concern would be, how can I say my prayers correctly? How to make sure that my wudu is correct, right? That is, he's, even at this time he's sick, he cannot articulate, but that is his concern, right? So you come to appreciate person. When you visit again and again, that's how it happens. Otherwise, one visit at a time, once in a while, would not enrich us with the information. So visiting is important. And the third, in fact, support is, let us train volunteers in the community. MashaAllah, the community has a pool of so many people, right? So many professions are there. You heard just now, Dr. Vandali telling us that he is in ICU, right? So we also have so many doctors here. But let us train, in fact, the volunteers who would give professional or semi-professional services to the disabled in the community, right? It's not a big thing. That let's train them that when somebody comes here, then we know how to handle these people. It's very important. Let me end with only showing you one hadith. There is so much reward of, in fact, supporting those who are what in need. But I'll just share with you one hadith and end the discussion because we don't do namaz. This is the hadith from the Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whereby Prophet says that, you know, I'll just read the translation. It says, one who helps a physically weak person in his affairs, Allah will assist him in his affairs and he will nominate for him angels on the day of judgment who will help this person go through the horrifying stages of the day of judgment, of the resurrection day, crossing the trenches of the fire such that the smokes and the harm of this fire would not even touch them, would not even reach them, and they would be able to just pass over the Sirat into Jannat. Just by helping a disabled person, Prophet says, Allah is going to appoint angels who are going to help you cross over the Sirat. No, the fire, even the smoke of the fire of Jannah would not touch you. And there are so many hadiths, we don't have time. All this is just to encourage us that when people who are disabled, who become sick in the community for any reason, it is important that the community gets together and give them full support and realize that this is something, not that they like it, they just are facing this thing. And when we give them support, in fact, you'll find that you will find them coming to the centers and the programs very often, inshallah. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. As I was saying, there is not much time, don't delay, but it is our dastur that whenever Shabi Jummah Majlis is recited, we remember the events of Karbala. And since I don't have time, I'll just say a few things. In Urdu, Mumineen, Karbala mein ek cheez jumko musalsal yaad dilati hai. Aur ye thi کہ پانی کو جو منع کیا گیا تھا, چھوٹے چھوٹے بچوں, آپ دیکھیں ہر شہید جب جاتا تھا اس نے کیا سنا, العطش العطش قد قتل, پیاس پیاس ہم کو مار ڈالتی ہے. یہاں تک جب عباس بھی آئے امام کے پاس اس نے جہاد کے لیے, جب عباس آئے ہیں اس وقت امام نے یہی پوچھا کہ عباس خیمے کی طرف سے کیا آواز آ رہی ہے, اس وقت جناب عباس نے کہا کہ بچے کہہ رہے ہیں العطش العطش قد قتل. امام نے کہا عباس کیا پانی کا کچھ التزام ہوتا ہے؟ یہی ہے اس لیے کہ میرے انیس نے کیا خوب کہا ہے, مظلوم کہہ رہا تھا کہ میں پیاسا پیاسا ہوں, مظلوم کہہ رہا تھا کہ میں پیاسا پیاسا ہوں, اے شمر تجھ سے مانگتا پانی ذرا سا ہوں, بتلاؤ میں ستاتا ہوں یا تم ستاتے ہو, میں تو دعائیں دیتا ہوں تم دل جلاتے ہو, مجھ کو نہیں رلاتے نبی کو رلاتے ہو, یہ تیر فاطمہ کے جگر پر. الا لا تقل الظالمین انا للہ و انا الیہ راجعون. رحم اللہ من قرأ الفاتحہ. بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. الحمد للہ رب العالمین الرحمن الرحیم مالک یوم الدین ایاک نعبد و ایاک نستعین اہدنا الصراط المستقیم صراط الذین انعمت علیہم غیر المغضوب علیہم ولا الضالین.